I walk by faith, not by sight. PJ, walk with me.
I will not fear no evil because I know who's in control. Hey, yo. Trouble all around me. I will not fret all because of whose hand I hold.
Your hand I hold.
I choose to trust you, cause it's in you I live, have my being, and I move. Even though the whole world changes, your word remains a lamp unto my feet and a light into my path as I walk by.
All the wrongs right,
so just keep on walking.
Whoa. train.
Yeah, yeah.
I'ma walk cause he's everything.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. I'ma walk with the King of Kings. Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Amen. We greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This is the day that the Lord hath made. And the Bible says, let us rejoice and be glad in it. And so on tonight, we're going to be talking about a faith that stays calm in a crisis, a faith that stays calm in a crisis. And that's really what we're going to be focusing on tonight. Now, in this series, here's my goal. And it is to share with you some very practical biblical principles that will literally help you navigate what we're calling and what we understand in the midst of all of the challenges that we're facing as we're thinking about this recovery. And then simultaneously, we're seeing gas prices and inflation occurring, and we're trying to navigate all of that. We want to give you the confidence through the Word of God to be able to navigate it. So I want you to learn how that you can control the controllable things in your life and then trust God for all the stuff that you can't control. And that's really critical. Now, during these times, in terms of what we're sharing and want to focus on, during our study, we're looking at the book of James. It's in the Bible because it was written and encouraged people who were experiencing very difficult times, severe pressure, stress, due to a crisis in the days that they were working in and living in. Now, the book of James only has 5 chapters and it has 108 verses, but it's loaded with insights that we need right now. So in fact, when I first started studying this book of James, I found 16 principles to literally guide us through this time of recovery after the pandemic. But the more I studied this book, as I prepared these studies, I found 3 more principles to share with you. So it looks like we're going to learn 19 life principles during our time together. And I hope you'll stick with me to learn all of them. Why? Because it will change your life. And now, this past week, I read a number of news articles that talked about the increasing number of outbursts of anger and stress and irritability in our society as we are recovering and struggling in terms of navigating. And it seems like a lot of people are really feeling angry, and they don't even know why. They don't even fully understand it. And people are angry for no reason, it appears to be, but there are reasons behind it. So today, I want to help you not only understand where anger comes from, that's important, whether it's in yourself or it's in somebody else, but I also want to share with you the practical steps from God's word on how to reduce the levels of anger in your life and in yourself and in others. And so this is a very important study at this point as we look at our lives in this new normal, because you've been feeling more short-tempered and even angrier. And here's the reality, and I want you to know that's what we're experiencing, I would say, globally, because we all are trying to navigate this new space that we're in. But the reality of it is that God is, it's not a strange situation to God. God already knew, number one, and number two, God already prepared in his word for us to be able to read and know how to navigate what we're dealing with. And so there's many things that we could think about even now to be angry about for real. And the combined factors of looking at all the things that we're seeing and all the things that we're having to deal with and how many things that are new that we've never experienced before. Now is the time that we have an opportunity to be able to learn how do we navigate life's stressful challenges and changes that we've had to go through, that we're going through, and that we're going to go through in a short time that's literally caused our emotions and anger and irritability to rise, just as frustration has risen. And so what we want to do again is get in the word to understand. And so that's why I'm teaching this series, literally to help us to cope with the emotional dis-ease as we begin to see how God is ordering our steps according to his word. So as I said in the previous Bible study that we talked about, I can't keep you from getting overwhelmed, but here's the thing I can do. I can give you some solutions when you're starting to feel that way. And I can help you to be able to be an overcomer and not be overwhelmed. And so that's what we're going to be focusing on. That's what we're going to be looking at. And on tonight, we're going to be sharing with you as I prepare to share this screen that you'll be able to see the outline. I hope you have your Bible study notes that you can come follow along with us as we get into this Bible study, as we look at the book of James. And today, what we're going to be looking at and really focusing on is what God has to say about anger, both in James and in other places in the Bible that we're going to begin to look at. Now, our series, if you remember, is called A Faith That Works When Life Doesn't. A Faith That Works When Life Doesn't. And so today we're going to look specifically at a faith that keeps me calm in the midst of crisis. It keeps me calm in a crisis. Anger may be the most misunderstood and most mismanaged emotion that we have as human beings. The wrong kind of anger is actually named as one of the seven deadly sins. But not all anger is a sin. And you need to understand that sometimes the most appropriate response to a situation is anger. Sometimes anger is an expression of love. So anger is not automatically a sin. In fact, my brothers and sisters, anger is a God-given capacity. The Bible tells us that God gets appropriately angry, and the only reason you're able to experience anger is because of the fact that you're created in God's image. Anger has its place. And if you were never angry, guess what? You would never be able to experience all that God has created us to experience. But there are such things as sinful anger, wrong anger, unrighteous anger. And you have to learn how to control your anger. You have to learn how to use it wisely. And you have to learn how to use it appropriately. That's what we're going to be talking about, to learn how to use anger in a righteous way, because mismanaged anger is a sin. But managed anger is actually an asset. So what I'm saying to you is that the problem really isn't anger as much as it is inappropriate expressions of anger. And this is key, because typically we go to one or two extremes. When we get angry, we either blow up or we clam up. We become a mute and we say nothing, or we become a maniac and we explode. And I say we either stew or we sprue. So one of you, this anger analogy in terms of what you're seeing and what you're experiencing, you know, you have an opportunity to be able to learn how to manage appropriately and how to appropriate your anger and what you need to do with it, so it doesn't turn into unrighteous indignation. So I want to help you to be able to navigate that tonight. And that's really what we're going to be focusing on. And what I've discovered is that when I think about what God is really bringing us to through the book of James, I learn that James has a way of putting the word of God so together that we are able to see clearly how to deal with these issues, these emotional issues. And James outlines that. So we look at what God has to say about managing your anger in a crisis. So let me share with you some things that I've learned. And first, I've discovered through study that men tend to lose their temper more often than women do. And typically, a woman will lose her temper about 3 to 4 times a week, while a man will typically lose his temper anywhere from 6 to 10 times a week. Women tend to get angrier at people, while men tend to get more often angry at things, like machines that break down. It's interesting to me that In studies, it is shown that single adults express anger twice as often as married adults, twice as often. And men are more physical with their anger than women are. So also, you're more likely to express anger at home than anywhere else. And finally, a statistic I learned is that successful marriages are not those marriages where anger and conflict doesn't exist, but rather a successful marriage is where they have learned to manage their anger. So when anger is managed, it produces awesome things in marriages. So when anger is managed, it can produce great friendships. When anger is managed, it produces great businesses. When anger is managed, it produces great athletes and great leaders. So how do I grow a faith that keeps me calm in a crisis or keeps me calm in conflict? Well, I want us today to look at six biblical steps, the principles of anger management that I'm going to give you that's going to be very helpful, extremely helpful for you. And here they are. Number one, as you're taking notes, here's the thing. You got to realize the cost of uncontrolled anger. That's the starting point. If you're going to learn to manage your anger, you've got to realize the cost of uncontrolled anger. Why? Because you're less likely to get angry if you remember that there's always a price tag for uncontrolled anger. It's very expensive. The Bible has a lot to say about that. And so Proverbs 29:22 shares with us, listen to this, a hot-tempered man gets into all kinds of what? Trouble. We're all probably understanding this and even not, you know, nodding our heads even now. A hot temper gets us into all kinds of trouble. You know what that's like. What kinds of trouble? Well, God gets very, very specific for us. Now, you've heard that confession is good for what? The soul. So as I read these next couple of verses, guess what? You might want to raise your hand at home if any of these are true of you. It causes all kinds of trouble. So how about this? Proverbs 15:18. Look at this passage of scripture. Hot tempers cause arguments. Anybody want to raise your hand to that? Hot tempers cause arguments. I've seen that. Hot tempers cause arguments. Proverbs 14:29 says this, anger causes mistakes. Anybody want to raise their hand to that? Anger causes mistake. Proverbs 14:17, people with hot tempers do foolish things. We've all done that. You see, you always lose when you lose your temper. You lose the respect of other people, and you can lose the love of family members. You can lose your job or you can lose your health. Why? If you respond to anger in the wrong way, you can stuff it. So let me just pause here and give you a word and help you, in particular, any parents that are watching tonight. And that is simply this. When you're frustrated, it's very tempting at that point to motivate your kids with anger. Why? Because it works in the short term. And anger gets people's attention. And there's a short-term payoff. But in the long run, anger is, as a parent, creates three big problems in your children. It creates anger in them, it creates apathy, and it creates alienation. All three, anger, apathy, and alienation in your children. Nothing destroys a relationship faster, my brothers and sisters, than anger. That's why the Bible says in Proverbs 11:29, and it's real clear on this for us, the fool who provokes his family to anger and resentment will finally have nothing worthwhile left. So the first step and how to keep your cool in a crisis is to realize the cost of uncontrolled anger. All right. It's going to cost me. It's not worth it. And here's the second thing I want to tell you in the second step, as we look at how do you manage this anger, how to stay calm in the midst of crises and conflict to resolve it. You got to manage it. Here's step two. The Bible says is to resolve to manage my anger. Now, what am I saying? Resolve. I'm saying this is a deliberate choice. You literally say to yourself, I'm tired of hurting myself. I am tired of hurting other people with my anger issues, and I'm choosing to change with God's help. I resolve to manage it. That's it. Quit saying that you can't control your anger. The devil is a liar. Because here's the thing, you can do it. You can control it. Stop making excuses. Accept responsibility for your reactions. See, nobody's holding a gun to your head. You're choosing to get angry. And the fact is, you have a whole lot more control than you want to admit to. Admit to about how your anger and other emotions. Have you ever been in a loud, angry fight at home and the telephone rings and you've been in a really heated conversation or argument and you've been all worked up and then the telephone rings and you pick up the phone and you all of a sudden you sweetly say, hello, what just happened? You were able to change your tone instantly because you wanted to. You have to resolve to change your anger. That's what you have to do. Proverbs 29:11 says this, a fool gives full vent to his anger, but a wise man keeps himself under control. If you're taking notes, I want you to circle this, the word keep. A wise man keeps himself under control. See, anger is a choice. It's controllable. So what does it mean to keep? It means I've got a choice. When you choose to get angry, you're choosing to do so. You have probably said, listen, as I've had and others, everybody's said this. You probably said at some point in time, you make me mad. But the bottom line is, my brothers and sisters, nobody can control your emotions without you giving them permission. You see, nothing can make me mad. Nothing can make me angry. It's my choice to get mad about it. And to resolve means to decide in advance what I'm going to do. Now, this is the second step in anger management. The second step is you must prepare in advance to manage. You must prepare in advance to manage. And here's the thing, you go, listen, you're saying, Pastor, even right now, you're saying, I know it's a weakness in me. I sprout out, or whatever way, whether I'm a mute or I'm a loud exploder. This is the reality. You can work on it before it happens. You can work on it before it happens. In the heat of the moment, it's difficult. You just say, listen, I'm going to choose to stop being that way. Step one, realize the cost of anger. And step two, resolve to manage it, realizing with God's help, I can change. Now, here's the third step. And this is very important, again, for you to do is to do what James talks about. He says, reflect before reacting. Step three in anger management is reflect before reacting. In other words, think before you speak. Don't respond impulsively. Pause, stop, be quiet. This is where James helps us. He gives us understanding in James 1. When we've been in this chapter for now, for about 5 weeks. And James in chapter 1, verse 19 and 20, he says this, and he's real poignant about this and outlines for us for what he is speaking to. Because he's quick to listen, he says, and slow to speak. and slow to get angry, because human anger will never bring about the righteous life that God desires. This is so important. This verse is literally packed with important principles, spiritual principles and spiritual truths. And I want to point out a couple of them for you. Looking at this verse there right now on your outline, the whole point of the book of James is to teach us how to live as Christians in a crisis. James says, if you claim to be a Christian and you claim to be a follower of Jesus Christ, then you need to act the same way he does in every situation. That's what he says. But James never just gives us a rule of conduct. He always gives us the reason why we should live a certain way. And he says this, you know what? Your behavior is determined by your beliefs. And God wants us to treat others the way he treats us. He always makes the point, whatever he's telling us to do in a crisis, he always makes the point from the inside out. He moves from being internal to external. He moves from being to doing. He moves from character to conduct. He moves from my identity in Christ to my activity in the world. He moves from belief to behavior. Always starts on the inside and it moves out. He always tells us why we should do something before he tells us what to do. Now, in this case, he says, I want you to be quick to listen and slow to speak and slow to get angry. Why? He says, because that's the way God treats you. He says, God is slow to get angry at you. And he says, if you're a follower of Christ, then you need to be like Christ. And he is slow to anger with us. He's always says, you need to be slow to get angry, because anger will never give you the kind of life that God wants you to live. He said, listen, it just doesn't work. That's what he pointed out. Now, in this passage that we're looking at today, James gives us three action steps in how to reflect before reacting. How to reflect before reacting. Notice three phrases. First, he says, if you want to control your anger, if you want to be calm in a crisis, first, be quick to listen. That's what he says. Be quick to listen. Did you know this? That you ought to be quick to listen. And that's important. Because here's what he's trying to show us, that the quickest way to diffuse somebody else's anger is you just calmly and genuinely listen to them. That's it. Use your ears. It's the quickest way to diffuse somebody's anger. Genuinely listen to them. See, being listened to calms people down. When you don't feel like you're being heard, you don't feel like you're being listened to, that's what makes you more angry. Wait a minute, you ain't listening to me. You get angry. But if you feel like somebody is listening to you, and I'm already angry if I'm listening to you, then guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to calm down. Because here's the thing. I don't need to explain this a lot to you, but I want you to get this because it's important. When you're angry, don't talk first. Listen first. If that's all you get out of this Bible study tonight, you're going to take a giant step toward managing your anger. Be quick to listen. Don't be quick to speak. Don't be quick to get your point across. Don't be trying to understand and get your point across quick and thinking in your mind instead of listening to the person. So don't be so quick to share your side of the story. He says, listen, be quick to listen. Why? Because listening calms people down. It calms you down. It calms them down. It's soothing. It relieves fear. So when people feel listened to, it reduces their frustration because it eases their hurt. He says, listen, reflect before reacting. You just listen. Be quick to listen. Here's the second thing he says, and this is important. He says this, reacting, relating. He says, you're talking about being slow to speak. This is what he's saying. He says, be slow to speak. Now, why does James say be quick to listen and slow to speak? Because anger control is basically a matter of mouth control. Anger control is a matter of mouth control. You tame your temper by taming your what? Your tongue. Now, James is going to have a lot more to say about this in the next chapter that we're going to be getting into. We're going to look at that later on. Anger management starts with this, watching your words. And if you're going to learn to control your anger, you must learn how to muzzle your mouth. The Bible says in Proverbs 29:11, it says, a stupid man gives free rein to his anger, but a wise man waits and let it grow cool. Notice how delay causes your anger to cool. Waits. That's the word waits. That's what he says. So here's the thing. Cool, it is biblical term. Chill out. A man, a wise man, lets his anger chill out. He lets his cool down. He let it cool down. That's the remedy to anger, because the longer you hold your temper, guess what? The more it improves and you get angry even more. But the way you're able to get rid of that is that you got to recognize what it is. Jefferson, the second president of the United States, said this, when you're angry, count to 10. The brother who thought that up, and he said, listen, if you're really angry, count to 100. Why? Because delay tends to calm you down. Don't count to 10, count to 100. And the third part of reflecting before reacting is the third thing James says. He says, listen, be quick to listen. Then he says, be slow to speak. And then he says, when he says, be slow to get angry. Now, if you do the first two parts of that verse, the third will be automatic. If you're quick to listen and you're slow to speak, guess what? You will automatically be slow to get angry. Now, I want you to notice that he twice uses the word slow. Two times he uses the word slow in one sentence. Why? Because James is trying to get you to delay your responses. Delay, as I said, is a great remedy to anger. So what do you do during the delay, while you're waiting, while you're cooling off? What do? During that time of waiting, the answer is this: you analyze and you try to understand your anger. You analyze and try to understand your anger. What's going on? Proverbs 19:11 is real important for us. The Bible says a wise man's wisdom gives him patience. See, the more understanding you have, the more patient you're going to be. Write this down. Write down, the more I understand my anger, the more I understand, I'll have understanding in terms of what I need to do and how I need to respond. So the more I understand my anger, the more understanding I'll be. That's what it is. Why am I angry? That's what you want to understand. This is what you need to get to this point, to begin to understand. Because the more I understand my spouse's anger, guess what? The more understanding I'll be of my spouse. The more I understand my child's anger, the more I'll be understanding of my child. So you got to recognize that. Even when it comes to being, the more you understand your coworker's anger, the better you're going to understand your coworker. Whatever the case may be, it is important. Now, let me give you three questions. And these are questions I want you to write these down. Three questions to ask yourself that you're considering when you're holding it back. You just put these in your mind. Get it in your mind. when you're angry, the first question I ask is, why? Why am I angry? And then the second question comes is, what do I really want? That's the question. What do I really want? Why am I angry? And what do I really want? Because something's being frustrated, beginning to frustrate you. What do I really want? Why am I angry? What do I really want? The third is, how can I get it? How can I get it? Blowing up is rarely the best way to get anything. It just doesn't work. So what am I saying is that if you reflect before reacting, then you can identify the causes, the root causes of your own anger. And this is key, because typically the root cause of anger is one of three things. It's hurt, or it's frustration, or it's fear. First, hurt. When you're wounded, here's the thing. When you're wounded, emotionally wounded, this is what you find yourself doing. Or not only emotionally, physically wounded. You hit your thumb. You get angry. When you get hurt, hurt causes anger. Second, frustration causes anger. So when you get irritated, when you're forced to wait, when nothing works, when we can't control a situation. Listen, have you ever had a baby that wouldn't stop crying? And you're getting angrier and angrier. Why? Because you can't make this baby stop crying. The more you need to control things in your life, the higher your anger quotient is going to be. High control equals high anger. So frustration causes anger. A third cause of anger is this: fear. When we get threatened, when we feel attacked, when we feel afraid, we get angry. Anger and insecurity go hand in hand. See, the more insecure I feel, the more angry I'm going to be. While you're being quick to listen and you're being slow to speak, while you are doing that, here's the thing. I would encourage you to silently pray Psalms 141:3. Lord, help me control my tongue and help me to be careful about what I say. That's it. And by the way, I'll just throw this in. The number one cause of reacting before you reflect. What causes reacting before you reflect on what you're doing? Proverbs 20 says alcohol. Drinking too much makes you loud and foolish. I didn't say it. That's what the Bible says. That's why the Bible says it's stupid to get drunk. Why? Because you don't think straight. How many arguments have taken place in because of alcohol? We react before reflecting instead of reflecting before we react. All right. So let's review. Step one, I realize the cost of anger. It's not worth it. The price is too expensive. There's always a payment to be made. And I could lose a lot. So step two, resolve to manage it. Make the decision. Stop saying I can't control it and start saying, with God's help, I can. Step three, James says to reflect before reacting. Quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Now, here's the fourth step. Release my anger appropriately. Is to remember, and remember I said this, and I've shared this with you before, but I got to learn how to release my anger appropriately. And I said, the problem isn't anger. The problem is inappropriate releases of it. See, Ephesians 4:26 is very clear for us. Paul shares, he says, listen, if you become angry, don't let your anger lead you into sin. Do you realize that you can get angry and not sin? That's what this verse says. It says, don't let your anger lead you into sin. Don't do it. What is he saying? There's a right way and there's a wrong way to express anger. There's an appropriate way and an inappropriate way to express anger. There's a helpful way and there's a harmful way to express anger. It's not the anger, it's how you release it. See, most of us express anger in ways that actually move us further away from the goal, and it doesn't bring us closer to what we want. See, our hurt healed, our frustrations resolved, our fears relieved. And here's the thing, God is trying to draw you closer. Now, here's the reality and what takes place in our lives and how we respond to it, because the Bible says in Ephesians 4:26, and the Bible says, if you become angry, don't let your anger lead you into sin. Don't do it. Don't allow that to take place. That's what this verse says. It says, listen, don't let your anger lead you into sin. And this is so important because there's a right way and there's a wrong way, as I shared with you before, to express what your anger. And God has given it to us, the ability to be able to express it in a healthy way, not an unhealthy way, in a helpful way that we're able to share and express how we feel. Because remember, again, as I said before, it's not the anger, it's how you release it. So how are you actually managing? What are you doing? How are you allowing yourself to be able to understand and to be drawn closer to God? Because if we want our hurt healed, our frustrations resolved, our fears relieved, we need God. And here's the thing, we got to draw closer to Him. Now, while I'm on this, I want to expose a myth that many people think and believe about anger. And that simply isn't true. And here's the idea that everybody has a set amount of anger. How many gallons of anger you got in you, like you're carrying a whole bucket of anger around all the time with you? The myth is that if you could get rid of all the anger in your life, in that bucket, and you could pour it out like in an outburst, or you pour it out, then you're, guess what? You're going to feel a whole lot better because you poured out the bucket. That's what we think. That sounds nice, but it just isn't true. Why? Because you don't have a bucket of anger inside of you. You have a factory. You have a factory of anger. That's human nature. Research shows that anger produces more anger. That aggression produces more aggression. That outbursts lead to more outbursts. And that more anger leads to more anger, not a reduction, but an increase. Well, I'll feel a whole lot better if I just get it all out. No, it actually becomes a habit. The Bible says in Proverbs 15:1, a gentle answer, the Bible speaks to, a gentle answer quiets anger, but a harsh one stirs it up. Why does a gentle answer quiet anger? Well, first, given a gentle answer is going to quiet your own soul. Have you noticed that the louder you speak, the more angry you become? And if you intentionally talk softer, your anger goes down. What's the best way to deal with anger in yourself? Well, don't suppress it. In other words, store it up on the inside of you. That can harm your body. Don't repress it. That's denying you're angry. And there's a word for repressed anger. It's called depression. Don't express it. That's inappropriate ways, like sarcasm, like you're an expert of whatever, manipulations, or getting your own way, or attacking, or pouting, or crazy behavior. Don't express it in inappropriate ways. The right way to deal with anger is to confess it. You just admit it. I'm angry. I'm angry. And then even more importantly is to admit the cause. I'm really hurt. I'm really frustrated. I'm really afraid. When you're angry at someone and you express anger, they get very defensive. But if you say, listen, I'm afraid, they're defenseless. Their defenses literally go down. I'm hurt. I'm hurt. And when you express that, people begin to listen and your frustration begins to wane. That's how you deal with your anger. Now, the next step that I'm going to give you from scripture is a key to listening permanently long-term change, soliciting permanent long-term change. And this is the thing you got to do. And if you're going to do this, this is what has to take place. And that is repattern my mind. I have to repattern my mind. That's the thing I have to do. Because when I repattern my mind, I can begin to go in a different direction. It's not until I repattern my mind that I can begin to go in the direction that I need to go, that I need to take, I need to go in my own life. And so you have to intentionally repattern your own mind, how you're thinking about things. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world. That's one of the things that Paul says in the book of Romans. He says, listen, don't do it. Here's what he says, and he's trying to get us to convey and understand explicitly ways in which we can begin to move in our own life. As I repattern my mind, here's what he's talking about. He says, listen, he says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. That's how you have to repattern your mind. And in repatterning your mind, here's the thing you got to do. You got to keep away, the Bible says, from angry. Keep away from angry, short-tempered people. And you will learn to be like them if you don't stay away from them. You got to repattern your mind, your thinking, and how you need to move and how you need to operate. That's why the scripture says in Proverbs, if you exploit or abuse your family, you'll end up with a fistful of air. You won't have anything because you don't know how to treat your family members. That's why it's important that you understand this. That's why the Bible says, husbands, you must love your wives and never treat them harshly. That's the key thing. There's a blessing in that for the husband to be able to love his wife as opposed to treating her harshly. And here's the final thing I want to share with you on tonight. Ask God to fill me with his love. This is key. Ask God, fill me with your love. That's why in 1 Corinthians, Paul shares, love is not easily angered. I love this passage. It says, love is not easily angered. So what do I have to do? I have to ask God to fill me with his love. That's why this is important, because the Bible says patience and encouragement come from God. I pray God will help you. You all agree with each other the way Christ Jesus wants us to. That's what Paul was sharing to the church, in the book of Romans, to the church at Rome. He was sharing this. But another thing Paul says in Galatians, he says, listen, the fruit of the Spirit is what? Patience. God, fill me with your patience. Fill me with your love. Because the reality of this is, the last verse we're going to look at tonight is, whatever is in your heart determines what you say. That's facts. Whatever is in your heart determines what you say. And so tonight, I want you to really think about these things. Realize the cost of uncontrolled anger. Know that there's a price that you pay. So you got to resolve to manage it, but you got to reflect before reacting. And the way you got to do that is you got to be quick to listen. You got to be slow to speak and slow to get angry. And here's the reality. If I want to understand what's going on, then I need to understand, why am I angry? And what do I really want? What's behind it? What do I really want? And then how do I get it? And here's the fourth thing I said, that I have to release my anger appropriately, that I can't just spew it out. I have to release it appropriately. I got to give a gentle, soft answer. Talk softer. And that anger, and you'll begin to deal with your anger in better ways. And the fifth thing we talked about is repattern my mind. Whatever I'm going through, I got to repattern my mind and ask God to fill me with his love. And that's what I want to leave you with tonight. I just believe God brought you here tonight to listen to this word because, hey, maybe you're going through something right now where you've been angry about a lot of different things and you've been trying to control it. Well, tonight I gave you in God's word ways in which you can control your anger. And that's so key. And it's so important. If you really want to be able to walk this Christian life and enjoy the life that God has given you and live to your full Christian potential, then the one thing you have to do is trust God in the process, in the word that he's given you. Be blessed, my brothers and sisters. I'm excited about this coming Sunday. Invite a friend to church. Invite someone to come. Tell them, listen, you don't even have to go out and buy no new suit. Put on that older suit. If you got something, if you want to, you got resources, go do it. But if you don't, listen, come as you are. God accepts you for who you are. And we want to share with you on this Resurrection Sunday, the word of God that's going to bless us and bless the house. Be blessed, my brothers and sisters. I'll see you on this Sunday.
And I came to tell you, it's coming down. It's coming down. Come on, get up and let's help us do this song right here. Back in the 80s.
Giants, you die. The bigger they are,
the harder
they fall.
Giants,
they die. When you worship,
listen,
when you worship,
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 when you shout,
just shout,
just shout.